anything right now, but like the next event happens and it's like, well, I have to stress about this new thing.
Everything's overwhelming right now. Other than that, I'm doing okay.
I've been staying in my own little bubble, trying to keep the mental health vibes up. Maybe disconnected, just like the news in general.
I'm choosing to ignore it. I don't know what else to do.
There's only like 6 months left of 2022.
Actually 4 months.
Is it actually? Yo.
I think Mercury is in like retrograde or something.
Monkeypox, Queen dying. The Don't Worry Darling movie. The Corn Kid. You know the meme? Oh my God, you don't know about the Corn Kid? He's like this TikTok star. I'm referring to things that happened in the last 3 weeks, but it's been a year.
It's the United States of Anxiety. I'm Kai Wright. Welcome to the show. And tonight's show is all about you, dear listener. This is a vibe check. As you just heard, for a lot of us, certainly for me, these are strange times. It was a summer of droughts and heat waves and natural disasters. Our hearts, of course, are with the folks in Puerto Rico today in particular as they confront yet another horrific storm. But I felt a real dissonance between the material reality of what's happening around us and just a general sense of saying, you know, I'm going to tune this out for now. And, you know, maybe that's a good thing. I don't know. The pandemic is the obvious example. It is seemingly over in the eyes of officialdom and a lot of individuals. But then everybody I know keeps getting COVID. And of course, we are in an election year that by all sober accounts could push our democracy past the edge of sustainability. And yet I don't think most of us are paying much attention to electoral politics at all. And again, maybe that's a good thing for all of our collective mental health. But anyway, I really don't have a sense of where everybody's at right now. Like, really, what's the vibe? So tonight, we're opening the phones to hear from you. This one is your show, so get your phones and your typing fingers ready. I'm going to throw out a few questions to stir the conversation, and the first one is about the overall national mood. So the classic polling question before every election is whether people feel the country is headed in the right or the wrong direction. And the answer has notably trended toward wrong direction in recent years, which is no surprise given all we've been through. So I actually want to hear from anyone who feels like we're headed in the right direction. What is it that you're seeing? If you feel that way, what is it you're seeing that the rest of us are not? 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692 for anyone who's feeling optimistic about the future of the country. What is the source of that optimism? 212-433-WNYC, or if you're watching on YouTube, drop it in the chat. And I am joined for tonight's vibe check by WNYC's own Brian Lehrer. As you know, Brian leads a two-hour live conversation every day right here on WNYC. So while some of y'all have been out at the beach or just unplugging personally and generally from the public conversation, Brian has been in it. And he is probably better positioned than anybody to check the vibe. So as we head into the fall and into this big election, we welcome Brian Lehrer. Brian, thanks for coming on, sir.
Hey, Kai. And the vibe is definitely corn boy. Never mind.
Corn boy on TikTok. I almost said on YouTube. It's on TikTok. All right. So Brian's going to walk us through some of his big takeaways from a busy summer of news. And listeners, in addition to answering my question for all of you, you can also ask Brian questions throughout the hour. 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692. YouTube, drop it in the chat. And for now, keep your questions focused on national politics, because that's what we're going to be talking about first. So if you got a question for Brian about national politics, call us up. Or if you want to answer my question, call us up, which is, again, this. Anyone who feels the country is headed in the right direction, what is the source of your optimism? 212-433-WNYC. Okay, so Brian, let us talk about national politics and where things stand right now. On September 27th, your show is starting the second iteration of your midterm election series. And as I understand it, based on popular demand, you're devoting a third of the series to the topic of democracy, both preserving it and improving it. So is it fair to say that the big takeaway in national politics for you and the listeners you've been hearing from is that concerns about democracy continue to be at the forefront?
Yes. So the series is called 30 Issues in 30 Days, and that's what it's going to be in 30 shows between September 27th and the election. And we did, as a prelude, a five-part series of call-ins this summer asking, what's your main midterm elections issue for people of different generations, starting with callers in their 20s or below and ending with callers in their 90s and above? Kai, we did get our first ever 100-year-old caller during that segment.
I was listening.
Cool.
I heard it. It was very cool.
And there were some generational differences, but the through line during all five parts was that people kept raising democracy in peril. And nobody raised it more than the 90-year-olds who've seen a lot of history, obviously. Yeah. Our final caller, maybe you heard it, was a 90-something woman who had escaped the Holocaust to come to this country. And she was shuddering over the echoes from that era that she sees rising here today. So that's a little bit of popular demand context.
Yeah. I mean, in some ways, it's surprising because I think a lot of analysis back in the spring expected that, you know, this issue, democracy, would fade into the background as we got further away from the Trump era and further away from January 6th. And particularly given more pressing concerns or more immediate concerns around health and around money that people had. Do you think it's the House hearings on January 6th that succeeded in keeping democracy in people's minds? Or what do you think it's owing to that this has managed to stay on people's minds?
I think the January 6th hearings, yes. I think that's not the only reason. But if you're asking about that, I'd say the extent of the conspiracy to block the transfer of power raised eyebrows and raised perceived threat levels, if you want to call it that, regarding democracy. I think the committee has done such a good job so far of explaining what really happened in a clear and organized way.
Yeah. I mean, what kinds of questions do you hear from people then when we're talking about democracy? Is it really only like, hey, we got to stop these MAGA people? How do I do that? Or is it more than that? Is there something else in the conversation you heard?
Much more. Democracy in peril, I'd say, maybe more than anything, from the politics of the stolen election, big lie, leading to all these states right now where they're making it harder for Democratic Party constituents to vote and where they're trying to change the laws so that politicians might be able to cancel election results that they pretend are invalid. And Republicans in various swing states are running on that. And I think it's also from the modern civil war proponents, if I can call them that, among some elements of the right, leading many of my callers to fear that the January 6th Capitol riot might be the beginning of an era,
right,
not just a one-off piece of lunacy.
Right. We're going to be in this space for a little bit. Well, let's go to a caller, Wilson in Yonkers, who I think wants to answer my question about what he's optimistic about if we're headed in the right direction. Wilson, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Glad to be a part of it. From what I've been experiencing and seeing, things are moving in the right direction. During COVID period, I was living with family in far upstate New York, right on the Canadian border, which is a very red area. I'm not seeing the amount of flag waving and everything I used to see.
I think we lost Wilson there for a second. That's okay, but I think I get the sense he's saying that up there in what was a red area, he is nonetheless, and what he was concerned about with flag waving and people being the MAGA crowd, I think is what he's really talking about.
I'm curious, Kai, maybe for another show, what has radicalized the Adirondacks?
Because
that's where he was all the way up there. That's a Lee Stefanik country.
Right.
Who went from being this relatively moderate New York Republican to being, all in on MAGA.
Let's go to Christina in Elizabeth, New Jersey. Christina, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So you are optimistic, Christina. What is the source of your optimism?
So I think that there are discussions that are being had right now that we tend to ignore when everybody has plenty of money to spend or the economy is going well for certain groups of people. I think we start ignoring poverty. We start ignoring homelessness problems. We start ignoring migrant problems. And I think right now we have an opportunity to have a conversation about how bad is healthcare for everybody? How bad is our situation with migrants? How bad is different aspects of people's lives? And we have an opportunity to do something about it. Even with the pandemic, we have seen the government can step in and start paying for testing for people. The government can step in and start paying for certain aspects of healthcare. And I think since we're having this conversation and we never have it when things are going, quote unquote, right, now is an opportunity that we might not get otherwise.
Can I ask you, Christina, because this is something that we talked about a lot back in 2020, even, you know, when the pandemic first started and, we can't go back to normal. And everybody was sort of saying, yeah, what's the opportunity to do some of these things in an ongoing way? So in your own life, like in your social circles, do you find that people are in fact ready to have the kinds of conversations you're saying this is an opportunity to have? Are you seeing that?
I'm actually seeing more people talking about politics and what's going on in our country than I've ever seen. I've been into paying attention to politics maybe for the last, let's say, 10 years myself, and then maybe the last 3 years, I've suddenly seen people wake up and start paying attention in ways I haven't seen before.
Got it. Thank you, Christina. I got time to sneak in one more real quick. Let's go to Deanna in Manhattan. Deanna.
Deanna. And I am absolutely thrilled. I am really doing something that most Americans should be doing. If you don't like the candidate, find a way to vote them out. And what happened was with me was an amazing story. Our previous mayor offered small businesses like myself an opportunity to get a grant because it all went during COVID to the big companies. And my representative promised me he'd send it in for me because I was a victim of identity theft, and he never did it. And he sat on it, and he never returned my calls. For months and months and months, I was waiting for this money that I really needed. And I just kept praying and praying and praying. And then just 3 weeks prior to the primaries, I get a call from the Democratic Party asking me what do I thought about our governor, our mayor, and would I vote for this person or that person? And I didn't even know my representative, the one that hurt me very badly.
Deanna, I got to wrap you up.
Wait. Primary, listen to this. And I ended up calling the woman he was running against, which I didn't know, asked her if I could make 5,000 calls for her to help her get elected. That's the way you're happy about democracy. That's the way you make change. And God bless America.
Thank you very much, Deanna. I'm Kai Wright. We're doing a Vibe Check tonight with WNYC's own Brian Lehrer. We'll be right back after a break. Welcome back. I'm Kai Wright, and I'm joined by WNYC's own Brian Lehrer. It's a vibe check tonight, guys. I'm posing some questions for you to get a sense of where people are at emotionally and mentally as this really strange summer concludes, and as we head into a huge election. We've been talking about national politics, but now I want to pivot a little bit and talk about personal and public safety, because that's been a huge aspect of our lives lately. It's come up a lot in the news. And so our next sort of vibe check question for everybody is going to be on this topic. On a scale of 1 to 10, how safe and secure do you feel right now? And I mean beyond crime, though that's certainly part of it. But I'm also thinking about stuff like public health, or about some of us whose lives are often the subject of people's political debates. Transgender and queer people, for instance, or immigrants and Muslim Americans. But whoever you are and however you think about safety and security, answer this for me. On a scale of 1 to 10, how secure do you feel right now? 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692. Or if you're watching on YouTube, drop it in the chat. How secure do you feel right now? 212-433-WNYC. Or, of course, if you have questions for Brian Lehrer about anything, it's a, what do we call it, an Ask You Anything segment. Instead of Ask the Mayor segment, it's an Ask Brian Anything segment. You can call us up for that as well, 212-433-WNYC. Okay, so Brian, safety is another big touchstone in your upcoming series, 30 Issues in 30 Days. And it's just been such a huge part of the conversation in New York this summer. How would you rank us overall as you've observed this conversation about public safety this summer? Where would you put the general anxiety on a scale of 1 to 10?
Oh, boy. 1 to 10 is hard, but it's higher than it's been in more than 20 years, I would say. Not because crime is as high as 20 years ago, but because it's going in the wrong direction for the first time since more than that. So I'd go very high with your scale and give you probably an 8 if I have to name a number. But I frame it more as crime and criminal justice, not just crime, because I think there's a tension in this city and in the country generally, and I think I'm not telling you anything that you don't know, but a tension between what I would call not wanting to go back to the bad old days of one kind or another kind. People don't want to go back to the bad old days of violent crime like the 1970s and 80s in New York City. And they also don't want to go back to the bad old days of mass incarceration like the 90s and early 2000s and arguably still today. But incarceration has come down over the last 10 years in the city. Bill de Blasio would tell you that reducing the Rikers Island population by thousands is one of his proudest accomplishments. Mm-hmm. Now it's going back up. So yeah. A central question for society, I think, in New York City and elsewhere is how do we find the right balance, or better yet, whole new way of approaching public safety that doesn't make it just a tug of war between those two dystopian bad old days, depending on who you are.
Yeah. And but I mean, just to get into our collective psyche for a minute, you said maybe it's about the change in crime rates. But I do wonder, crime is historically low. It's higher than it, or it's crime rates are going up, but they're still historically low. And it's so profound of a concern. I heard one of your shows about New York's job recovery, and that we're lagging behind the rest of the country, and that this is because of fears of crime that suburbanites, people outside of the city, don't want to come in, and that's slowing job growth. I mean, it just feels like it has become this concern about safety. It feels like it has become just a really dominant issue here, and I think in a lot of cities around the country. I mean, what do you really think is behind it if it's not just the numbers?
Well, somewhat it is directional. People feel differently if something is getting better than something, if something is getting worse, as opposed to the absolute numbers. But also crime is such a big media story, right? The tabloids and local TV news play up the most sensational crimes because people are already concerned, but they play them up like they're the new normal for right. most people. And I would say people in the suburbs, since you cited the suburbs, who come into the city, let's say those who come in mostly for theater or other cultural events, are the most susceptible to seeing things as worse than they are, and maybe commuters to work too, but at least the commuters have daily contact. And there is also COVID. We are in a steady state, as you mentioned at the top. You made a reference to it. You know, we have about 15 people per day dying from COVID all summer in New York City, according to the New York Times COVID tracker. And that compares to less than 2 murders citywide per day, by the way, if we want to compare COVID to fatal crime. And these things combined keep people jittery, even as people return to pre-pandemic activities to an increasing degree, I think.
Yeah. I'm talking with WNYC's Brian Lehrer about his big takeaways from our disorientingly busy and high-stakes summer of news, I have to say. And we're taking your calls right now as part of our vibe check tonight. I'm asking you, how safe and secure do you or don't you feel? On a scale of 1 to 10, how secure do you feel right now? 212-433-WNYC. Or if you are watching on YouTube, drop it in the chat. And let's go to Cooper in Brooklyn Heights. Cooper, welcome to the show.
Hey, how you doing?
I am well. So how? What about you? On a scale of 1 to 10, how do you feel and what puts you in that put you at that place?
I rated about a 2, just because I think long-term, the effort to, like, curb climate change just isn't really happening at the speed it needs to. So, like, as much as, like, crime rates go up, crime rates go down or something like that, that's all deck chairs on the Titanic.
Mm. Okay. Deck chairs on the Titanic. Ryan, how often do you hear that?
Oh, I hear it a lot. And in that generational call-in series that we did, it was interesting to me. And, of course, this is a thoroughly unscientific sample. But the callers who most mentioned climate change were the youngest cohort, 20 and below. We had a 15-year-old who called in, talked about climate change, and the oldest cohort. And I think that that's because the youngest people among us, they have their whole lives ahead of them to worry about the, you know, increasing threat of climate change. And maybe the older people, the oldest people, that was the 90-plus cohort, takes the longer view. They're not so worried about, you know, this week's grocery bills for raising their kids and that kind of thing. So maybe the youngest and the oldest have the longest term view among us, but we certainly hear climate a lot. And enough that we this year instituted a weekly climate story of the week segment to make sure that it stays front and center where I think it needs to be among these things that seem more tangible and of the moment. Mm.
Let's hear from Onika in Brooklyn. Welcome to the show.
Hi. So it's my level of anxiety about public safety, especially living in New York City, has to do more with domestic terrorism targeting towards Black and brown communities opposed to street crime. I live in a high-crime neighborhood. You know, just last night I heard gunshots. Well, actually early this morning. But I'm more so afraid of domestic terrorism because that has been met historically in the United States with impunity.
Mm-hmm.
The low-level crimes, well, not low-level crimes, the street crimes, interpersonal crimes, those are addressed by law enforcement. But domestic terrorism, law enforcement officers are among those who hold those same ideas of the people who perpetrate those crimes.
Thank you for that, Onika. And this is, Brian, I think, connects to, in my mind, to your democracy questions from our beginning of our conversation, right? I mean, how much does this come up with folks?
It comes up all the time. We saw an example of the ongoing threat of domestic terrorism this past week when, you know, Trump said on a radio show that if he's indicted on any kind of criminal charges, there will be trouble like this country has never seen. Well, what would that mean he's comparing it to, since the country has seen plenty of trouble over the years? Like, how about the first Civil War? Or it's seen major riots sparked by a variety of things we all know and more. And Trump waves that statement off as a prediction, not incitement. But it sure can sound like the time he said, "Proud Boys, stand back and stand by." Remember that? Rather than denounce them, as he was asked to do in that televised presidential debate. And then, of course, the Proud Boys and the Oath Keepers and others felt that they were called to arms by Trump for January 6th. that's come out in some of their trials and in some new January 6th rioters video from the Capitol that was released just last week. So absolutely that plays centrally into people's concerns about democracy.
Yeah. Let's go to Terry in Cortland Manor. Terry, welcome to the show. Oh, do we have Terry? You there? Okay, well, in the meantime, let's go to Jeremy in Prospect Park, Brooklyn. Jeremy, welcome to the show.
Hey. Hey, how are you? Thanks for taking my call. Good afternoon, Kai and Ryan. Subway ridership and the safety around subways is completely out of control, and it really takes away from the quality of living of anybody who lives in New York City who relies on that public transportation and who just wants to get around in the evening. So that is, to me, brings everything what would be a 9 or a 10 down to maybe a 6 or a 7. It's got to be an issue. The subways are just a nonsense. And I have guests, have people coming from out of town visiting me, and I'm like, don't take the subway. Mm. And it's like, that's what makes the city so great, is the ability to get around through public transportation and go into Manhattan, go anywhere. So that's my take, guys.
Thank you, Jeremy. This, again, feels relative to me, Brian. You know, I mean, I know I talk to other New Yorkers, you know, who have been here a long time. I mean, I don't know how long Jeremy's been here, who are like, the subways are perfectly fine. First off, are you able to fact check for, I can't do it off the top of my head, like the level of crime on the subway right now. Are you able to do that off the top of your head? Sorry.
I don't have it in front of me, but it's, you know, like a lot of other street crime, it's higher than it was a few years ago, but it's much lower than it was decades ago. And so to some degree, it very much is a matter of perception. And, you know, there's no single answer. But by and large, taking the subway is very safe.
Yeah. All right. I want to get to one more, I think, on this line of question about what makes how secure you do or don't feel. Let's go to Terry in Cortland Manor. That's what we were trying to get on earlier. Terry, are you there now?
Yeah, I've been here. I hope you can you hear me now?
We can. Sorry, that was on our end.
Okay. Yes, I am 73, and I am highly alarmed by the rollbacks of so many advances I've seen in my lifetime, the whole issue of abortion rights, voting suppression, things like that. Not only am I alarmed by the problems with these on their own, but also the fact that we need so very much to be working on climate change, and these rollbacks are derailing from what we need to do on climate change. And then as an added little problem, my own local problem is very recently there's been a proposal to erect a 14-story cell tower in my very quiet forested street. And this would also be right next to a county forest. And in scrambling to fight this, I've been learning about the inadequacies of the very outdated 1996 Telecommunications Act, some of the provisions of which make it impossible to fight the cell tower on health and safety grounds.
Terry, can I ask you, just because we're running out of time, but I want to follow up with one of the things you mentioned was the rollback and access to abortion. And I wonder about in your circle. So there's a lot of talk when the Supreme Court, of course, started the summer by reversing Roe about the long-term impact this would have politically in terms of how much it would galvanize voters and how much it would fuel movements. What has been your experience in terms of how much that is on the forefront of people in your world's minds?
Well, with the pandemic and everything, I just got my second booster, but I've been more isolated than usual. My contacts are mainly online, but from what I can tell, I think it is having an effect on women of a lot of ages. I certainly hope so. And now with this apparent national proposal by Republicans to ban abortions, I hope that will have even more of a galvanizing effect.
Thank you for that, Terry. And going back to the subway point, I just want to point out, somebody on YouTube points out that, you know, when the stats are one factor, but it's beyond the stats. It's the shocking incidents, like when the woman was pushed in the rail track and killed. There have been some large incidents that have affected people's emotional relationship to the subway. So it's more than statistics, and I think that's a good point. So thank you for sharing that. Brian, moving on for a second from public safety, as we start to wrap up this part of the conversation, I do want to get to another issue that is going to come up in your 30 issues in 30 days that is one of the big takeaways from the news cycle this summer, and that is housing. And, you know, there has been, and this connects to how people feel safe or secure for sure, how comfortable they feel in their housing. But there is a housing affordability crisis happening nationwide. New York City is certainly at the center of that. You had several call-ins about this over the course of the summer. What were you hearing from people in terms of like the choices that they're being forced to make?
Well, I mean, long-term, middle-class and working-class wages have stagnated on average. That's true for decades now. And affordable housing supply is not kept up or kept down, if you want to look at it that way. With that, market forces in the situation of unequal supply and demand, too much demand for the supply, favors the suppliers, the landlords. So we see the gentrification of neighborhood by neighborhood after neighborhood. Obviously, it's lower income people who get displaced or have to make themselves house poor by paying such a big percentage of their income in rent. We know lower income people are disproportionately people of color, too. And so the cycle of white privilege in the economy gets perpetuated by this. And it's really hard. You know, I have to say, looking at all the choices that politicians have to make, I mean, there was the mass construction of public housing way back in the 1930s when FDR and the federal government believed in helping to fund it. That's been gone for a long, long time. The city and state governments feel that they don't have the money at the scale needed. So we get deals with the private sector, compromises like tax breaks for affordable housing construction or mandatory 20% affordable to get a zoning exemption for big, mostly market rate developments, you know. And these are imperfect solutions that aren't up to the task of meeting the actual need. And I don't know that anybody has the real answer for New York City.
Yeah, but it's certainly on the forefront of everybody I know's mind, the cost of what it takes to have a place to live. I am talking with WNYC's Brian Lehrer about his big takeaways from a busy and high-stakes summer of news and about the midterm elections that are coming this fall. We're going to take a break and then shift gears one more time because I want to talk about good news. I want to know what got you pumped this summer or what's got you excited about the fall. 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692. Or if you're watching on YouTube, of course, drop it in the chat. What got you excited this summer? More Brian and more of your calls after a break. Welcome back. I'm Kai Wright, and I'm joined by WNYC's own Brian Lehrer for a vibe check tonight. I've been posing questions for you to get a sense of where everybody's at emotionally and mentally as this summer concludes and as we head into a huge election. And with the time we've got left, I want to talk about what was good this summer. So listeners, what got you pumped this summer? What has you super excited about the fall? 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692. Or if you're watching on YouTube, drop it in the chat. Summer of 2022 is officially in its last few days. That's a sad thing, but it's true. So what's something about it that was great? 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692. And Brian, I know that you've got a few things you're really happy about, and a lot of them came from the world of sports, I gather, and it starts with baseball. Yes? Is there going to be a Subway Series?
Well, I don't know if there's going to be a Subway Series, but yes, on the lighter side of what's there, you know, to be happy about right now, I'd say in general, it's a fun time to be a New York sports fan. And to start with baseball, the Yankees and Mets are both headed for the postseason, whether or not there will be a Subway Series, and with some very likable stars to watch. In fact, the Mets just this afternoon tied a record for the most strikeouts in a game in Major League history in a very exciting game. And Aaron Judge of the Yankees hit his 58th and 59th home runs of the season. That's one behind Babe Ruth and two behind Roger Maris for the Yankees and American League records. And off they go. Subway Series, not out of the question.
Now, I got to put you on the spot here, Brian, because I was told before the show that it's not totally clear where Brian falls on the Yankees versus Mets conversation. So are you willing here tonight to give us a sense?
Brian is a little more Yankees, but loves both teams. My parents, my parents were from the Bronx. Yankee fans, my first games were going to Yankee Stadium. But I grew up in Queens, just a few miles from Shea Stadium, and so was going to Mets games as a kid all the time, and I have a genuine affection for both teams.
All right. Listeners, I want to hear from you. We've got a few minutes left in this, and we've heard all the bad news. We need to hear the good news from you as well. What got you excited this summer? 212-433-WNYC. That's 212-433-9692. Or if you're watching on YouTube, drop it in the chat. Yochi on YouTube says, I was excited with the ascendance of the Linda Lindas, a very young punk rock band. They released their debut album on April 8th. So the Linda Lindas are getting Yochi pumped. Brian, more sports news that I understand you're kind of excited about is, you know, we had a pretty cool U.S. Open tournament this year. It has more fans than I think it had in 2019. So it had a bigger audience than it had even pre-pandemic, right?
Those are the stats that I've seen, which makes it different than a lot of other live events, which have not recovered their full audiences from before the pandemic. And along with a beautiful retirement ceremony for Serena Williams, I hope a lot of people saw that. We also had the rise of some young American players who should be prominent and fun to watch for years to come, and diverse, like Frances Tiafoe, Danielle Collins, and Coco Gauff. We haven't had a lot of American tennis champions other than Serena Williams for a while, and all in that fabulous complex that got built for the city, thanks to Mayor David Dinkins. Can I give you a little historical footnote here?
Please do.
Rudy Giuliani, when he was mayor, refused to attend a single match at the U.S. Open. He was definitely not America's mayor in that respect, as a kind of childish, I think, rebuke to Dinkins. But the stats that I've seen say the tournament is more than $500 million boon to the city's economy each year. And after Giuliani left office, Mayor Bloomberg called it the only good athletic sports stadium deal, not just in New York, but in the country, because we know they often bomb in terms of public benefit. And, you know, Dinkins hoped that he could help diversify tennis, and that seems to be getting realized, at least to some degree.
I'm going to conclude with David in the Bronx. We've got maybe 30 seconds for you, David, but I really want you to tell us why you're excited, because I'm excited for you.
Okay. I'm excited because I'm in love. That really helps in this time. Also, my kids are grown, so my child support has stopped. that's been like really great. You know, I have money now, like I haven't had in 20, 25 years. So I don't know.
So you have fallen in love, and you got some money in your pocket, and the sun is still shining at least a little bit until daylight savings time. And so, David, you're feeling it. And you know what, David? I hear you. Thank you for that.
And I love your show. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Thank you. Brian, before we sign out here, 30 issues in 30 days. It's coming up September 27th. What else are you going to get to in 30 seconds that we haven't talked about?
We're definitely going to get to abortion rights. We're definitely going to get to the culture wars in public education. We're definitely going to get to climate. We just mentioned that briefly. So those are some things to look forward to every show starting a week from Tuesday until just before the election.
Okay. We will leave it there. That is our vibe check for the end of summer of 2022. You can, of course, catch Brian Lehrer every weekday from 10 a.m. to noon on WNYC or wherever you get your podcast. Brian, thanks for this. It was a lot of fun.
Always great, Kai.
Okay, and before we conclude, I've got a big announcement about our show. But there's a cliffhanger here. And the reason I'm holding off on the announcement will become clear shortly, so just stay with me here. First, since the official end of the summer is a few days away, it's time to wrap up our summer playlist project. I'm joined by our producer, Regina Dehir. Hey, Regina.
Hi, Kai.
Okay, so the last time you joined us for a check-in, you gave us an update on this project that you've been overseeing. We've asked listeners to send us the song that they're really feeling this summer and tell us the story behind that summer jam, what it means to them. You've been making a playlist. They're on Spotify. People have been loving it. Ooh. It's now the end of summer. How did all this go?
Danielle Smith started us off with some really great selections, you know, Beyonce, Queen Janet Jackson, really got us off strong. We got emails here and there with people adding songs, but if you remember, we were missing some of the stories
behind it.
But after we asked again, things really picked up.
People started telling a story. We got tons of different things, right?
Yes, the playlist was indeed a big hit, you know. I heard a lot of feedback from people even around WNYC, the offices over here, like my friend Luke, who works on another WNYC show, All of It, hosted by Allison Stewart. They talk about music and culture all the time, and he had a selection from Prince.
Hey, this is Luke, recording this actually in the WNYC offices here in Soho. I'm going to go with none other than the most unstoppable man of the summer of 84, Prince, and his song Let's Go Crazy from his album and movie Purple Rain that made him a megastar. Now, I wasn't alive in 1984, but to me and my parents who were in high school at the time, this song and the album overall screams summer. Purple Rain was released on June 25th, 1984, right when summer reaches its peak. And what better message for the peak of summer than an upbeat, funky, dance rock anthem with crazy solos telling you to literally forget all your worries and just go crazy.
Now, I was also not alive in 1984, but I do know Prince, and Let's Go Crazy is definitely a summer jam.
Definitely a summer jam. I was alive in 1984, and, you know, you really can't beat that album. What else did we hear?
Yeah, we also got a really great email from our listener, Ellen, who wrote, quote, I just got a convertible, lifelong dream come true, and have been making a convertible B-word playlist all summer. Whenever someone rides in the car, I ask them to add a song, so I have memories of all of them. Plus, I crowdsource suggestions on Facebook. So the playlist isn't just songs I love, but also the favorites from all my favorite people. It makes me so happy.
Aww.
Many O's with the so. Very happy. And she also sent us some of her favorites, like Bleachers, Stop Making This Hurt. Who she just saw live for the first time this summer with her daughter. Do you know Bleacher Sky?
I sure don't.
Well, I have some recommendations by him and produced by him. So if you'd like some suggestions, that's a conversation for another time.
To be continued.
Yes. So we also had a listener, Stacy, who sent a voicemail that still makes me laugh.
My summer jam that's been going on since spring is Tame Impala's I'm a Man off the Currents album. It's a sexy, chill vibe for sexy outdoor summer evenings. I'm just thinking about what I said and the implications.
So I've also been curating the playlist with songs that I'm encountering in my own life. After all, the joy of this project has truly been the creative liberties that I've gotten to take. For instance, the song Yalla Habibi came from my Zumba class. Big hit, highly recommend. And I even got one selection, Night Fever by the Bee Gees, from seeing you post a sick reel on Instagram of these twins skating to the song.
The Griffin Brothers, yeah, I love that account, and great pick.
Yeah, it's the best pick. So as we end the playlist, I just want to end by thanking our listeners for streaming and participating in the playlist. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have.
Indeed. And I was actually at a public radio conference recently. Shout out to all the behind the scenes folks in public radio. And I got a whole list of ideas from them. I think my favorite one came from Deshaun in Minneapolis, who said Ready or Not by the Fugees was the soundtrack to his young adult life back when he was living here in New York City.
Great song. Ready or not, here I come. You can't hide.
Gonna find you. And I picked that one for a reason, because we're ending this playlist project with a big announcement about the show. Minneapolis is actually one of several cities we are welcoming into our community here on Sunday evenings. Starting next week, we are expanding this conversation to a national radio audience. Now, of course, we already have people around the country who follow through the podcast or stream it on YouTube. But I'm just really excited about this move into a national public radio network. It's just going to be an incredible opportunity to keep learning from each other across the country and across our communities. So same show you already know and follow, but with a bunch of new people joining us. And alongside that, we're making two changes I want to tell you about. First, we have got a new name. Because if we're honest, we are done being anxious, y'all. That's just not helpful. We're a lot more focused now on a conversation about the society we want to live in, rather than just wringing our hands over the hateful crowd. So as of right now, our show's new name is Notes from America with Kai Wright.
Notes from America with Kai Wright.
That's us. You heard it here. And our second change to go along with this new name, we have a new theme song, and it's gonna be the final song we add to our summer playlist. So, to introduce that new theme, I want to bring on our sound designer and engineer, Jared Paul. Hey, Jared.
Hey, Kai. Hey, Regina.
So, first off, what we're about to do here is kind of an homage to one of your favorite podcasts, right, Jared, called Song Exploder.
Yeah, Song Exploder, one of my favorite shows. I'm going to kind of imitate their format here for a minute, so I hope they don't mind.
Okay. All right, so take it away. What tell us about our new theme song.
So, while we were planning this new phase of the show, we knew we wanted new theme music, but we didn't have our name yet. I had started about a dozen demos, none of them were really feeling right yet. But then I think right after the meeting where we chose the name, Notes from America, I think I pretty much hung up from that meeting and then was immediately like, oh, notes, boom. Once we had the name, I figured we needed some music with a lot of notes, which I know sounds a little silly. Most music has notes. But in my mind, that meant using the chromatic scale, which is every key on the piano, every white and black key, not skipping any. We all knew we needed a theme that was energetic. Kai mentioned he's into 70s soul. I put down this upbeat soul beat, put some distortion and filters on it, stuff like that. Added this fun clapping rhythm over it. And then I let that beat build. And then I added some great guest musicians. Shout out to my friends Mel Sooo on cello, Spencer Hattendorf on sax, and our very own Kusha Navidar on trumpet. So Kai often talks about our show as being like a town square for conversation, and I wanted the music to reflect that. I wanted it to build up to a busy climactic ending with lots of instruments in conversation with each other, like everyone getting together in the town square with their instruments. And now the Notes from America theme in its entirety.
The new Notes from America is a production of WNYC Studios. Follow us wherever you get your podcast and hit us up on our brand new social handles. Find us on both Instagram and Twitter at Notes with Kai. Our new theme music is written by Jared Paul, who also handles mixing and sound design. Matthew Mirando is our live engineer. Our team also includes Karen Frillman, Regina Dehir, Rahima Nassa, Kusha Navidar, and Lindsay Foster Thomas. A welcome aboard to our new intern, Vanessa Handy. And I am Kai Wright. Thanks for spending time with us tonight, and welcome to Notes from America. I'll see you next week.